Coming up on this edition of Cogeco News, we discuss asymptomatic spreading of the coronavirus, donating blood during COVID-19, and we profile a tennis superstar on the rise. Welcome inside the Your TV studio for this Tuesday edition of Cogeco News. Truly local, my name is Clark Heiple. There has been much debate over the likelihood of the coronavirus being spread through asymptomatic hosts. That topic and much more as we attempt to digest the latest happenings with COVID-19 and our citizens' response in the province. Local Medical Officer of Health, Dr. Jim Chirico, explains the latest scientific understanding of COVID spread.
There are cases of people being asymptomatic and being able to spread. They think that the science is showing that it's less likely. The ones that are symptomatic are the ones that have the ability to spread it to more people. So you have to also qualify, and it gets a bit confusing, those that are asymptomatic that stay asymptomatic or never develop symptoms, and those that at one point are asymptomatic, but we call them pre-symptomatic because they then do develop symptoms. And most of the cases, when they go back and look at them, we'll find out that actually they did have some very mild symptoms, but didn't really realize it or didn't feel sick. So asymptomatic spread isn't that common, and you should be more concerned certainly with people that you come in contact with. You should assume everybody has it, except for these social circles that we talked about, and keep that 2 meter distancing.
I just wanted to get your thought. There was a yoga gathering at the waterfront on the weekend. It looked like several dozen people, socially distant. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, there are many guidelines out, and they can be very confusing, and we're trying to sort through it. And so as we open up, we want to ensure the main premise is that people social distance. And if you look at the guidelines for recreational activities, they do fall within that. And I know that there are lots of gray areas, and we're all working together to work on it. But we also believe that if people will social distance and keep that 2 meters, that it minimizes the risk. And certainly mental health and well-being is very, very important. So while we don't want everybody to be mingling together, for sure, if they maintain that social distancing, that's what we want to accomplish.
And lastly, how are we doing here in our district? Are you satisfied with the response from the community and where we're headed?
The community has done an exceptional job, and they should be very proud. And we hope that and ask that continue so that we don't have any real sudden increases in the number of cases. So they have been really, really good at doing the social distancing, and our numbers are very, very low. And our percent positivity rate with all the testing that's been done is only 0.3%, which is some of the lowest in the province. So it's very, very low, and we hope that that certainly continues. We expect a second wave, and we hope that if people continue to do what they're being asked to, that it will really reduce the impact of the second wave.
And taking a look at the numbers as of 3 p.m. this June 16th, no new cases of the coronavirus, 30 historical cases. 28 of those resolved, one person in self-isolation, and one person has died in the North Bay Parry Sound District due to the coronavirus. Nipissing First Nation Chief Scott McLeod is keenly aware of many significant incidents involving various police departments and Indigenous people in Canada. They continue to this day, he says. We asked the chief about policing and the Anishinaabeg Police Service. McLeod said that forces need much more resources.
Yeah, that's a hard question to answer, because it goes back to the systematic racism where municipalities, whether it be West Nipissing or North Bay or Toronto, in their constitution, they have the fundamental right for protection. Therefore, it's a requirement on government to spend money on police services and security for the people so everybody's safe. Well, on First Nations, it's different. First Nations, it's not constitutional right for us to have that. Through the Indian Act, it just becomes a program, and government has underfunded this chronically for decades. And so we're given enough money to basically fail in our systems. And that's one of the things that the average Canadians don't understand, is that, you know, we try to do what we can with the money we have, but it's not on the same level playing field.
Meanwhile, exponential pressure is being placed on police forces around the globe following the death of George Floyd in late May. That pressure is being felt in North Bay as the community police force is in tune to the accountability of the serving community, the responsibility of serving the community. Following the death of George Floyd late last month in Minneapolis, Minnesota, police forces around the world are under the microscope.
Well aware in regards to that every action of every individual officer can affect the service as a whole, but they're now also understanding the fact that every action of every officer in the North Bay Police Service can affect policing around the world too. Social media and media attention certainly can heighten and expand the breach in regards to delivering a message, either positive or negative. Our members are well aware that positive messaging to the public is far better than the negative messaging that can occur from their actions. So I think that and the professional approach we have to training and education within the service, and it's been long-standing here for many years about the action we take as regards to a police service and training to be modernized. I always like to use the words progressive and responsive to our community. I think has been beneficial to where we are now.
95% of the public has an HD camera and videotape machine in their pockets. Is it a good thing to be constantly recorded no matter what an officer does?
Absolutely. It's something that we cannot hide from. In fact, it's something that has been beneficial to us, not only in investigations, but also in regards to our ability to interact with the public and understand certain things that are occurring within the public. So the real-time audio streaming, real-time video streaming that occurs from things such as the protest, we're able to assess the police service in making decisions along the way.
We have reached break time here on this Tuesday edition of Cogeco News. More local news, weather, and sports right after this. Welcome back to Cogeco News. While donating blood during COVID-19 may not have been top of mind for many, especially during all the physical distancing restrictions, the need for blood donations never went away. This despite the mobile blood donor clinic in North Bay being removed. Canadian Blood Services has now made some modifications to make it easier and safer for you to give blood in the communities that you're able to do so. Melissa Candelaria from our sister station at Halton News went through the process herself and has this report.
As restrictions start to ease across the province, the need to donate blood is increasing. Canadian Blood Services is hoping more people will come out to donate. Territory manager for Hamilton Burlington Region, Simrat Diol, says they had a great response when the pandemic began.
We got a lot of national response all across Canada, and our donor centers were booking out quite well. But right now, the need for blood is rising. We're seeing that hospitals are starting to do elective procedures where blood is needed. So we're asking that donors come in as much as they can, for males every 2 months and for females every 3 months.
Canadian Blood Services is asking anyone and everyone to donate, especially those with universal blood type O negative. Diol says they have made changes to all donation centers to ease any safety concerns.
The two big things are that we're only doing now appointment basis. So we do not take walk-ins at the moment. That's just to limit the number of people that we have inside our donor centers. And the second thing that we did is a lot of wellness checks and physical distancing inside the donor centers as well. So when you first walk in, there will be initial wellness checks, which go through COVID questions, and you'll also be going through a temperature check. And then when you're inside, you'll see that there's a lot more taping on the ground just to make sure that everyone is 6 feet apart at all times. Canadian Blood Services, our donor centers are places of wellness, and donor safety is our number one priority. So at all times, we make sure that all of our nurses and staff and all donors coming in are wearing a mask at all time. That way we make sure everyone is safe.
Canadian Blood Services have made adjustments to many of their donation centers across the province to make room for more appointments.
We do have donor centers all over the GTA, all over Canada. So just go to blood.ca. You can type in your postal code and find the donor center nearest to you.
By the way, this is National Blood Donor Week, with Sunday being World Blood Donor Day. So what a perfect time to go and donate blood. All you have to do again is to go on blood.ca and register. Reporting for Halton News, I'm Melissa Candelaria.
And earlier this year, the mobile blood donor clinic was removed from this community, so you'll have to travel to Sudbury if you want to donate blood. The Clean, Green, Beautiful movement continues as we're just days away from the first day of summer. While social distancing remains in place, litter pickups remain as well. A local Francophone bank is backing the environmentally conscious initiative. Case Alliance has stepped up with the purchasing of thousands of bags for the Clean, Green, Beautiful movement. Case Alliance staff reaffirmed their support to the program late last week.
Case is on board because the community is one of our values. We value the community. We believe we're a strong community partner, and it just fits part of our Eco Solutions mandate, where we are planting trees for every birth that's in our region.
And it's safe to say the money is where your mouth is. You are sponsoring the bags. Tell us about that.
Absolutely. Well, it's a big part of the community, and we encourage our staff to go out and do it themselves. We've organized some staff evenings where staff has gotten together and gone out and cleaned garbage or picked up garbage.
Rookie Councillor Joanne Brusso is the council lead for the CGB North Bay movement.
It's very exciting to have the case involved. They actually have been involved for 2 years, and they're quite easily convinced because it fits with their vision and their mission for Northern Ontario.
How many bags have they stepped up to buy? Like, is there a number?
They contributed to the purchase of 5,000 bags last year, and this year they were one of the main sponsors for another 5,000 bags.
And for you, councillors have to be on certain boards, and they do so because they have to do sometimes. However, you do this because you enjoy it. You enjoy helping out Harriet and her team. Why?
I enjoy helping out the team because it's part of the civic pride. I'd love to have all of North Bay citizens take pride in their city, take ownership of their cities. And it's such an easy solution that if we all do a little bit, the city can look so much better.
Trash Terminator Harriet Madigan is tireless in the effort to keep North Bay clean. Case Alliance is a big backer for Madigan and Company.
They're not the only ones, but they're the main sponsor. And they are really into environmental solutions and being an eco-friendly corporation. So really, really happy that they're involved, and they've made a commitment beyond this year, actually.
If someone is a little tentative about coming out and volunteering, I recommend that they show up and have some fun. Is that fair to say?
Oh, absolutely. We still have to do our physical distancing. It is always a lot of fun. There's a good feeling when you take part in contributing to the health and wealth of your community.
And as of today, the groups are 10 people maximum, so it's good probably to register in advance, maybe shoot you a message so you can coordinate the size of the groups.
That's right, so we need 10, but if more show up, we'll divide up into teams and move in different directions.
It is time for another installment of the Entertainment Insider. We take a look at Spike Lee's newest masterpiece, Da Five Bloods.
Hey everyone, it's Pat Conta, the Entertainment Insider. Today I'm looking at a team up between Netflix and film auteur Spike Lee, his latest, Da Five Bloods, which is streaming now on Netflix. This is a really interesting story about four African-American men who were serving in the U.S. Army during the Vietnam War together. They found some gold, decided to bury it, and weren't able to go back and get it. So now, they're on a quest to find the gold and bring the remains of their fallen captain, played by Chadwick Boseman, back home to the United States. There are a lot of different twists and turns along the way. One of the men's son end up coming to and joining the group as well. And it's a really fantastic story. And actually, I think in a lot of ways, it's one of the more conventional ones that Spike Lee has ever told on film. Of course, with it being Spike Lee, it's very layered. There's a lot of different meanings to what's being shown on screen. One way in particular I think that is really, really fascinating is the way that Lee films the flashback scenes differently. It's shot on a different, in a different way. The film grain is a little grainier, and it almost feels like a 1980s Vietnam War movie, more akin to like the Rambo series, which actually gets specifically brought up during the film as well. The performances here are really strong, especially from Delroy Lindo, who plays Paul, who is the sometimes main focus, sometimes antagonist of the film. He actually does a really good job carrying much of the load of this, but the rest of the cast around him does a really good job of propping him up as he plays a very complex character that I think is really fascinating to watch on screen. The direction, of course, is well done. Spike Lee is one of the best directors of a generation. And of course, that there are a lot of themes here dealing with race. And given the current political climate that we're in, this movie probably couldn't have come at a better time. There definitely is some gruesome depictions of violence and some strong language, so if that's not your thing, this movie is probably a pass for you. But anyone else who's interested in watching a film that covers a lot of interesting topics in a very poignant time in history, this one's definitely worth checking out. At 2.5 hours, it may seem like a long film, but really it's smooth and it just flies by. There's really not a lot of pacing issues with it. I think that it actually did not feel the full 2.5 hours. So this one is definitely worth going out of your time to see. I think it's not only one of the best films that are out there to watch right now, but I think it's one of Spike Lee's best films in history. So I think this one's definitely worth checking out. It's a great take, a very interesting story. And of course, if you're a fan of Spike Lee, this one's gonna be right up your alley. I say give this one a watch. I hope it gets a bit of attention during awards season. I think it's well-deserved. The Defy Blood, streaming now on Netflix.
We have reached break time here on this Tuesday edition of Cogeco News. Greg Esterbrooks has your 5-day weather forecast. Stay tuned for that.
Weather is brought to you by Canador College. Great things happen here.
Welcome back, everybody. Greg Esterbrooks here with an incredible weather forecast for you on an incredible day. Absolutely beautiful and hot on Tuesday. It's going to stay beautiful for the rest of the week. There is an outside chance of a shower by the weekend. The temperatures will soar into the low 30s with the humidex. The mid-30s are on the way. But it's going to be a little pre-summer, summer-like weather for this part of June. Let's take a look at the complete weather forecast. Forecast we go, and we can tell you that overnight tonight is going to be clear and 12 degrees. Sunny and hot on Wednesday, high of 28, humidex 31, UV index 9, very high. The low on Wednesday, clear and 18. For Thursday, sunny and hot, 29. Clear overnight on Thursday, and it will be 17. Friday, up to 31, a mix of sun and cloud. Small chance of a shower on Friday. Friday night, a greater chance of a shower and a low of 19. And for Saturday, it's going to be hot again, a mix of sun and cloud. Small chance of a shower during the day, and a smallest chance of a shower overnight on Saturday with a low of 17. Moving on to the almanac, the high on Monday was 22, the low was 7. And the normals of this time of the year are 23 and 11. When we come back, a profile on Adrian Cadahan, a rising tennis star known as a phenom. There's also another kind of tennis player known, well, as a hypal. Sports after this.
Sports is brought to you by TAG Construction for all your construction needs.
Welcome back to Cogeco News. Big news from the CHL. More specifically, it concerns us in the OHL and the North Bay Battalion. Perhaps there could be fall hockey after all. Commissioner of the OHL, David Branch, released this statement, which you will see on your screen, and I will have the pleasure of reading it to you. The OHL is looking forward to the upcoming hockey season. We plan to drop the puck in the fall and will follow the lead of government and public health agencies on when it is safe to get back on the ice. Our players and coaches are getting ready to play, and our teams are working on their plans to provide a great community experience for our fans and the community that they have come to expect from OHL hockey, unquote. That is David Branch, the commissioner of the OHL. Not too many details following that statement, whether or not fans will be allowed in the old barn. We will have to just wait and see more details to come, and we're looking to have an interview with GM Adam Dennis of the battalion tomorrow. Moving on to tennis. At age 16, Adrian Cadahan has a big future. The North Bay native has been training in Toronto until COVID-19 shut his training down. Now Adrian is back home and playing at the Granite Club. Here's Greg Esterbrooks.
You could be looking at one of the future stars of Canadian men's tennis. 16-year-old North Bay native Adrian Cadahan is home training for the summer after his training in Toronto was cut short by COVID-19. So in North Bay, he's playing with different players, including his father, who was a Davis Cupper in his native Philippines some 35 years ago. Now, Adrian is hoping to go even further as a singles player.
You know, I'm doing a lot of fitness, and you know, now that the courts are open, I'm playing as much tennis as I can with my coach Francois and my good friend Charlie Hancock, and you know, getting some advices from my coaches in Toronto, staying in contact with them, and they're giving me advice, and I'm just executing that on the court.
Francois Rockman is the professional at the Granite Club and was the old coach of Adrian Cadahan when he was very young. He gives a refreshing take on what he saw in Adrian when he was very young on the court.
It was a bunch of moments. Funny enough, though, right at the beginning, you would have never thought Adrian was evolving the player that he's now. As a younger kid, he was just one of the crowd. He was keen. He was always working hard.
And more on that story tomorrow. Now, June 16th holds a very special day in my heart. Today is my mother Louise's birthday. Happy birthday, dear mom. Happy birthday to you. A little off tune there. My mom was born and raised in Hamilton, and my mother Louise has been a caring mother for me and my family, including my sister Kimberly, through thick and thin, taught us valuable life lessons with a firm but loving approach. She's dedicated to my father, Harold, for nearly 40 years of marriage. I love you, Mom, and I can't wait for our socially distant visit this weekend. Now, Greg wrote this. This makes it even better. Quote, Louise knows Greg is the son she always wanted. My dear, typical Greg. Well, he'll be back on the news desk on Wednesday. We'll see you then live at 5. Thank you.